All right, too loud or okay? Okay. I don't know if I can operate this. They wanted Bernie Sanders. And I was the closest they could get. So I will make sure it's huge. So, an unexpected journey. I'll be talking some today about undergraduates and other ones. 1978, my very first talk was in this lecture room, and I'm now teaching in here 3 days a week as well. So I'm very familiar with this place. So first,
can you turn it up?
In here?
No.
And I yell maybe? I don't think it can go any higher without screeching. Better? Okay, we've got feedback by the way, I think. All right, so made some recognitions back here. My sons and my grandchildren back there, names up here. Very, very happy that they could be here today. We have some excellent soccer players in that group. Also should recognize one other person here. And Kathy worked here at Hendrix for 22 years. We've been married for 46 years. So I could never have done anything without her. So she was with me all the way. And also wanted to mention a couple of other distinguished guests. I don't know if Warfield is here. Are you here yet, Warfield? Well, great. But John Stuckey here on the front row was a chair. Okay, if I move, it squeals. But Dr. Stuckey was the chair of the department when I came here, and I wouldn't be here without him. And he and Orpheo were big friends and big influences on me. I hope for the best. And I hope some of you have been watching these things. I didn't know if you were sharp enough. Okay, so I'll start out. I didn't practice this talk, and I don't know how long it takes, so whenever I'm told to shut up, I'll stop in mid-sentence. Mr. Eva Scheidler, some of you maybe knew Dr. Scheidler if you've been here on the earth long enough, but many of you may have heard of him. He was the person that I replaced when I came to him. And after Bob passed away, I was talking to his wife, and I told her, I couldn't tell her how many students had told me what Bob meant to their life and how valuable they were and how much they appreciated him. And Eva said, yes, that's probably true, and just as many of them hated him. So, Eva and I knew that she was exaggerating. Basically, you say you can't please everybody, so that's a good thing to know. Dr. Matt Ellis. Okay, so I'll just try to talk loud, maybe emote better. So Dr. Matt Ellis was President Hendrix, and he was getting fairly old when I talked to him about this, but he told me there were three phases to a person's life. There was youth, middle age, and you sure are looking good. Dr. Ellis said that's all he ever heard, but you sure are looking good. What came in was a surprise that he was still alive. I hear a lot of that, you sure are looking good. Now, many of you will not recognize the Hendrix connection with Yogi Berra. So I just wanted to quote something from him. So Yogi Berra was in the Navy in World War II when he came back. His hometown of St. Louis had a reception for him and all this sort of stuff. And I'll say something, he said something like this: I really thank the people who made this day necessary. So, I thought that's sort of the way I felt about it. Anyway, I will show you the connection of yogi to humans. Very few people know about this. It was difficult, though, because normally when you give an honorary degree, it would be something like Doctor of Science, Doctor of Humane Letters, and something like that. And they didn't quite know what to do with yogi, so. Now, for those of you who are terminally serious, that was a joke. Okay, so this is something for you to think about during the class. If this was some painting or something, what would you name this? All right, so I'm from Southwest Arkansas down near Texarkana, and my science career started with a project we had for a science fair. And so I didn't know much. I had a friend who had chickens out in the country, and so our science fair project was to take chicken water and put different colors in it. So we put food coloring in there, we have red and blue and so forth. And we wanted to see if the eggs would come out the same color as the eggs. We were crestfallen. We didn't win at all. So, Hendrix has been a big part of my life and Kathy's life, and our two children graduated from Hendrix too. So we've had a lot of connections. It's been family and Hendrix as far as I'm concerned. So Dr. Stuckey will remember this. It was tough in the early days. I stole this from one of my students. So I'll show you a little bit about what we've done. Not so much in the classroom, although that's been wonderful, but also about my research. So I don't see anybody here that actually worked on this project with me. So I see a few hands going up around the room, the old timers who can barely see what's up here. this was a big deal back then, and the big shots at big places were trying to make it. It was ludicrous for us to pretend that we could make this stuff, but we did learn a lot about chemistry and publish some papers and so forth. So I know there's one person in this room who worked on this project. John, are you here? John Bird over here, who's now at Ohio State. And Kevin Rainey also. Some of you may know Kevin. He's head of the Department of Biochem and Molecular Biology at UAMS. So we thought we could maybe cure cancer and cure malaria. It didn't work out, but we did get publications. We did teach people, I think, a lot about science and chemistry. So things that we've been doing since then, we got into microscale organic chemistry labs fairly early in the game, and green chemistry. So I started reading things in journal articles about people who are trying to be more environmentally aware. And so I think our general chemistry program, because of Liz John, and also the organic work that we did, I think we became one of the leaders in the country in green chemistry and microscale results. So the other thing we worked on was chemical ecology, and I'll talk a little bit about both of these, but not too much. If you want me to slow down or speak louder, just yell. It's not going to bother me anymore. So some of you may recall or have seen t-shirts that we've had. So I introduced something a long time ago. I made this up. It's the Fausett Institute for Green Organic Chemistry. And I got a couple of Latin scholars here to translate my slogan that I had. It's down here at the bottom, you can read it. But It says, let loose the toads of great peace upon the world to go and do their good work. As far as I can tell, it doesn't really mean anything, but I kind of liked it. And so we have the Latin version here, which is classic. And so we've made up t-shirts many years and sell them for whatever it cost us. So they're like walking billboards for our green chemistry program. And this particular one, we have the Professor Toad down here and the orangutan up there. And I just happened to have one of those shirts here with me. I think the president has one. Yes, I thought I'd be always kissing up the president. So, very, very lovely shirt, and we still have a few left. They're $10. So, I'll talk a little bit about some of our research at the Frontiers of Science. Very, very sharp. I'll let you digest this for me. So, one of the things that we really enjoyed is collaborations. And so when we started looking at mammalian chemical communication, I would give talks at various places in the country and abroad, and usually would attract chemists and biologists, becoming field biologists and some conservation biologists. And there aren't many chemists who want to work on this kind of stuff because there's no money in it. You can't get big grants. If we're working on something that was destroying cotton plants and so forth, then you can get money for that. But it's just something that I enjoy doing. I like animals a lot. And I like to work especially with endangered species. So the way we look at it, the more you know about an animal from a lot of different angles and different sorts of scientists working on it, maybe the greater chance we have to perpetuate the animal. So we did a lot of work first with African elephants, a lot of it in conjunction with the elephant sanctuary that's not too far away from here. But whenever I go give talks, then I have biologists and chemists, and oftentimes biologists would come up to me and ask if I'd like to collaborate. So once I was at the Smithsonian's area for endangered species in Front Royal, Virginia, speaking about our elephant research, and a woman came up to me afterwards who was had a DVM and a PhD, and so she said, how would you like to have some Maine wolf urine? And I said, who wouldn't? We got into that collaboration, and I told some of you will remember John Guthrie, who was here in Hendrix for many years, a chaplain and so forth. And so I told John, I said, my research students and I know more about the urine of Maine wolves than anybody else in the world. And John said, so? I thought that was quite a reasonable response. So lemurs, we've done a bunch of lemur stuff, one at Duke University. We got the most publicity for any paper we ever published on this one about the binturongs. And binturongs are the sometimes called bear cats. And let me pull this back some, will that help? All right. Anyway, so sometimes called bear cats, and their urine smells like buttered popcorn. And so if you do a Google search on buttered popcorn and binturongs, you'll see something about our paper. We got stuff all over the world publishing that stuff. But we found the compound in there that was causing the smell, and it's exactly the same compound that makes buttered popcorn smell that way, and taco shells. And it smelled mostly to me like Fritos. I sniffed quite a bit of it. It's inhaled. We also got contacted by someone on the North Slope of Alaska and wanted us to analyze whale urine, bowhead whales. And so you can imagine how to collect urine from a whale. So you get the idea. I'll give you a chance to look at this for a second. I don't like to read slides to people, so I figure most of you are able to read this for yourself.
We can't read the top, Dr.
Oh, top just says photographed by G. Dallimore, but this the text reads an inordinate fondness for beetles. So this is just a whole bunch of beetles. But the idea was that Xavius Howling, somebody said, what could he find out about the mind of the creator, says, from the works of creation? And he said, an inordinate fondness for beetles. So there is a book in our library called An Inordinate Fondness for Beetles, if you want to go read that. And so I decided after the way our research was going that we had to let up. Some people think it's odd to be doing research on urine, but if you've gone to the doctor any time of your life, you've given a urine sample, and there's a reason for that. We couldn't get a grant from NSF once. We did get one really big grant from NSF for our elephant stuff, but it's hard to get one because the people there said, oh, all you'll get is what their diet is. And if that's true, then nobody, there's no reason for any MDs to ever take a urine. So anyway, you can tell what the elephant's doing. This was the way that you can get Maine wolf urine. They come over and urinate on this stainless steel. But Maine wolves have a problem. They can't metabolize amino acids that have sulfur in them. And so they crystallize and they get in the urinary tract, and so they have big problems. But we found out which chemicals were causing that to happen. So, another thing you have to read, or not. Okay. So I'll just show you an example. Wait. Anybody here from Texas? Okay, I'll leave it up a little longer. So one of the odd projects we got into, looking, these little beetles are drug deal. Anyway, these little beetles, they burrow into bark, so they're bark beetles, and they find a place on a tree that's sort of rotten or something. So the males get in there, they send out a pheromone, which is an aggregation pheromone, and then it causes the females to come in, and close proximity leads to reproduction. So they're a big problem with the Douglas fir trees in the Pacific Northwest, and also with the southern pines. So not exactly the same beetle, but all in the same genes. So this compound is the one that's the aggregation pheromone for the southern pine beetles, and then these isomers for the Douglas fir trees. So we found exactly these same compounds in African elephant urine, and we also found the precursors. So it is well known how the beetles make these compounds starting from these, and we found these same compounds in the elephant urine. So it just seemed more interesting to me. It infers that the way that the beetle makes it the same way as the elephant makes it. So it sort of may seem weird that you could find the same compound in the elephants as you see in the beetles, but nature is very conservative about these things. So the things you see in your DNA, it doesn't matter if you're a human or a slime mold or anything else, you're going to have the same building blocks in there. Unfortunately, we don't know yet if these are chemical signals. That's something my collaborators are supposed to work at. But we did work out a lab for our chemistry class, so that worked out well. I think I'm talking too fast. I don't know what I'll slow down. How's your mom and me doing? okay, so I've started my online research group for the last few years, the International House of Chemistry. And we, Hendrix has become much more diverse. So those of you who are alumni, if you haven't been here in a long time, there's a lot more diversity in the student body than there used to be. And that's on purpose, and that's a great thing. So this is the latest group of my research students. And we were out in San Francisco at a meeting, so we took this. But I couldn't put up your slides of all of the students that I've worked with on research. There's been a lot of them over the years. Some back, there were not cameras back when we started. So this can kind of represent, I suppose, all those students that I've had the pleasure of doing research with. But I would say also the students that I've been able just to interact with through labs and through lectures and so forth. I have been around 20-year-olds much more in my adult life than I've been around people my own age. And I enjoy being around that group of people, and I will sincerely miss that. I'm not looking forward to hanging out with people of my own. So people keep asking me, are you dreading your retirement? Are you looking forward to your retirement? Why are you retiring? What are you going to do when you retire? You know, all these kinds of questions like that. And I really don't know, because I don't have any hobbies or anything. So I'm thinking, Mondays, Andy Griffith. Tuesday, Price is Right. We're going to have Wednesday, Lawrence Welk. There are lots of things you can do. But I will definitely miss it, and will do my best to still hang around Hendrix too. Oops, not that one. We don't want to show it yet. There we go. So this was your task. Anybody come up with a good name? Yes?
Madonna and John.
You saw it. You cheated.
You always cheat.
You would be a good. So, actually, I showed this slide to a former Hendrix faculty member, and she said, it looks like Madonna and Child, and I couldn't believe it. Anyway, this was from one of my trips to Australia. Now, I was afraid I wouldn't have time for this, but I'm glad I do, so I have to drag something else. So, a few years ago, it was like 2003, I think, I was fortunate enough to win a teaching award. And so with that, I had to go to Washington, D.C. and talk. Warfield's here now. Who are my teachers? I grew up in the segregated South in the 50s and 60s, in the days where education for blacks and whites was euphemistically called separate but equal. I remember separate water fountains, separate waiting rooms, and the Little Rock Central crisis of 1957. I remember Dr. King and I Have a Dream and the March on Washington. My early childhood in a small town in southwest Arkansas, however, was idyllic. I spent countless weekends and hot, lazy summer days with my maternal and paternal grandparents in the country, where I roamed the creeks and fields. My grandparents didn't have indoor plumbing. Water was drawn from a well. Their formal education was not extensive, but they were wise in the ways of the woods and the natural world and the daily doings of country folk, and they were my teachers. As I grew up, my parents were devoutly religious. Whenever the church doors opened, we were there. My parents didn't just speak their religion, however, they lived it. Through their actions, they taught me selfless service to others on a daily basis. In the days of segregation and racial tension, I never heard a racial slur uttered in my home. My parents were unable to attend college, but they impressed on me the value of education. They also taught lessons that neither a classroom nor the culture of the times could provide. I tried to exemplify their lessons of fairness, equality, and service in my classroom every day. I owe them more than I can ever express. They were my teachers. I'm a proud product of the public schools of Arkansas from grades 1 through 12, where I had many inspirational teachers. I was a tolerably good student throughout. I read a lot and had wide-ranging interests, with a rather quirky sense of humor inherited from my dad. After high school, I ventured forth into the big world to a college located a whopping 50 miles from my hometown. But it was good for me there. From dedicated professors, I learned a lot, from J. Alfred Prufrock to the periodic table. A special mentor lured me down the path of science as we worked together with other students to probe the natural chemistry of lakes and streams, similar to those creeks that I explored as a child. Thus, the seeds were sown for the educational value of each student, faculty, of collaborations, my subsequent passion. I was fortunate once more to have sterling mentors through graduate school, again in Arkansas, and in postdoctoral research after I left the state. During those years and for most of my time at Hendrix, our research focused on synthetic organic chemistry, that is, making big molecules out of small ones. More recently, we have moved in other directions, from pedagogy toward more environmentally benign or green chemistry laboratories, and in research toward pachyderms. Sorry, this is so long. We have been actively implementing green chemistry concepts and practices into our lectures and teaching labs. Our aim is to send forth citizens, future teachers, scientists, government community leaders, and others who are imbued with the sensitivity to green issues. In recent years, my students and I, along with some excellent collaborators, have shifted much of our research to a study of chemical communication among African elephants, due largely to the close proximity of Riddle's Elephant Sanctuary and my long fascination with all creatures great and small. I got it all. What a joy it has been to be around the majestic elephants. They have been my teachers, as have the interesting and dedicated people around the world who care for them and study them. I have been shamelessly foisting my personal reminiscences upon you for the last few minutes, but trust that I might be forgiven on such a rare and delightful occasion as this. As a reward for your indulgence, I'll give you a couple of take-home elephant facts before I wrap up. African elephants, but not Asians, can squirt liquid from their ears, possibly from some as yet undefined gland. That's true. Asian elephants, but not Africans, can sweat between their toes and around their cuticles. Good luck working this information smoothly into conversation. At the office this week. Now I must finish. Heartfelt thanks for this great honor today are due to the Council for Advancement and Support of Education and the Carnegie Foundation for the Advancement of Teaching. This award is for all my teachers, from my grandparents in the Arkansas countryside throughout all my formal education. This award is especially for my parents, my wonderful wife of 33 years, and her parents. That wasn't long ago. And our two sons and their families, of whom we could not be more proud. They have tolerated my idiosyncrasies and have given me love and support in return. This award is for my students, past and present. They have been my teachers and have made the long hours all worthwhile. This award is for my colleagues at Hendrix College who have created a superb intellectual environment where I have gladly and greedily swallowed education in great gulps over the last 25 years. Now it's 39 years. This award is for my colleagues in the Department of Chemistry at Hendrix. They have been my teachers and my friends. My life has been good and I've been greatly blessed. As a closing quote appropriate for a grizzled college professor, I've turned to Louisiana writer James Lee Burke and some baseball imagery in his novel, A Stained White Radiance. Quote, sometimes it feels good to be over a half century old and to still be a player, a bit scarred perhaps, but still out there on the mound, messing them up with sliders and spitters when your fastball won't hum anymore. End of quote. But you know, this award offers hope that there's still a little life in my old fastball after all. So today was such an event as this. I'm greatly humbled and overwhelmed that you showed up and stayed. I owe so much to Hendrix. I can't express it. So anyway, thank you very much. Is the Undertaker's favorite element. Bury him. So the reason I put it in there though was Kathy told me to remember this and I knew I'd forget it. So we're going to be with Hendrix for a long, long time because we have a niche in the columbarium.
Despite that crack about Texas, thank you. At this point, I'd like to invite Christina Burns, Kool-Aid class of 2005, to join us up here and to offer a few words. She has something very special to share with you.
Hi, so Dr. Goodwin, more than 2 years ago, when word leaked out that you were contemplating retirement, and once people got over the shock that that might really happen, several of your former students contacted the Hendrix Development Office to inform the college that they were not going to let that occasion slip by without paying tribute to you for all you have done to mentor and inspire so many of us. So many of us who have suffered gladly the trials and tribulations you inflicted upon us in the classroom and in the lab. So my colleagues on what we're calling the steering committee to lead the fundraising effort for this tribute are Newton Seitzinger, class of 1981, Mike Crowder, class of 1982, Julie McCoy, class of 1985, John Bird, class of 1987, Michael Kaiser, class of 1987, Stephen Gonzalez, class of 1996, and myself, the class of 2005. On behalf of this group and the former students, friends, colleagues, too numerous to mention, I'm happy to inform you that we are establishing the Thomas E. Goodwin Odyssey Professorship of Undergraduate Research. And
the college. It is a privilege to acknowledge the work of Christina, the whole steering committee, and so many others in this room and beyond it whose efforts and generosity have led to the creation of the Tom Goodwin Odyssey Professorship for Undergraduate Research. The 12 words inscribed in the plaque Christina just gave to Tom say it well: exacting scientist, consummate teacher, prominent advocate for undergraduate research, and exemplary colleague. Of course, we were paying by the word for those things on the plaque, so we couldn't put everything there we wanted. I'm sure a lot of you have descriptions of Tom you think should be added. Stand-up comic, t-shirt huckster, kangaroo Madonna, gentleman, friend, inspiration, conscience, person with the biggest heart at Hendrix College. Thank you, Tom, from all of us.
I still have a couple of minutes. The president is very shy. I was able to pull him out of his shell for a few minutes, and I know he needed this mic. There are people in Greenbrier who know that, so, but we love you. I just wondered if you had a class with me, whether you were one that hated me, my guts, could you just stand up for me? Thanks so much for this and for being here and for just being here.